Welcome to another presentation about the origin of the Carolina Bays. The Glacier Ice Impact Hypothesis proposes that the Carolina Bays originated from secondary impacts of ice boulders ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. Some people have challenged this hypothesis by claiming that the aerodynamic forces encountered during the launch and the re-entry portions of the ballistic trajectories would disintegrate the ice boulders. Previously, I showed that the compressive strength of glacier ice is sufficient to withstand aerodynamic re-entry. This presentation examines what happens when the ice boulders are launched during the excavation stage of an extraterrestrial impact on an ice sheet. Scientists who study impact cratering usually identify three mechanisms that occur when a projectile hits a target: contact and compression, excavation, and modification. The contact and compression stage of an extraterrestrial impact lasts less than 1 second. The swiftly moving projectile pushes target material out of its path, compressing it and accelerating it to high velocity. Most of the projectile's initial kinetic energy is transferred to the target in a volume not much larger than the projectile itself. Shock pressures developed during the early stages of a hypervelocity impact reach hundreds of gigapascals that far exceed the yield strength of both projectile and target. The great pressure from hyperspeed impacts creates planar deformation features in quartz crystals that distinguish impact craters from craters formed by terrestrial processes such as volcanism. The excavation phase of a crater made by the comet with a diameter of 2 kilometers lasts approximately 30 seconds. During the excavation phase, a hemispherical shockwave propagates into the target. The decompression that follows the shockwave of the impact sets target material in motion and starts opening a crater and ejecting material ballistically. Some of the earliest and fastest ejecta consist of the vaporized projectile, which is dispersed in an expanding vapor plume. The last debris ejected from the extraterrestrial impact has the least energy and falls close around the crater. An experiment by Professor Peter Schultz shows a projectile penetrating an ice sheet. The shockwave breaks up the ice, and the intense heat of the impact creates a steam plume explosion that ejects the ice pieces in ballistic trajectories. This is the contact and compression stage of the impact. When the projectile plunges into the surface, the shock fronts spread and propagate into both projectile and target. Both projectile and target materials may melt or vaporize upon unloading from such pressures. High-speed jets of strongly shocked material squirt out of the interface between the projectile and target. Most of the projectile's initial kinetic energy is transferred to the target. The underlying material is compressed, heated, and accelerated to high speed. In this image, the ice sheet still retains its rectangular shape because the shockwave has not been transmitted beyond the impact point. When the excavation phase starts, we can see that the ice sheet is fracturing from the shockwave of the impact. The expansion of the vapor plume helps to propel the ice pieces ejected by the impact. The innermost ejecta are launched first and travel the fastest following the steepest trajectories. Ejecta originating farther from the center are launched later and move more slowly, falling closer to the impact point. It is important to rely on experimental results. In 2021, a paper by Silver et al. Described the impact on an ice sheet using a model that showed the layer of ice undergoing volume changes as if it were a gas. This does not reflect reality. Experiments show that the ice sheet breaks apart from the shock of the impact and the pieces of ice are ejected away from the point of impact. The computer model is wrong because it does not produce results that correspond to the real physical world. In actual experiments, the volume of the ice does not change as indicated in the model. Unfortunately, such models can misguide many people. Previous calculations using the law of conservation of energy have shown that the secondary impacts that produce a Carolina Bays would have corresponded to the impact energy of a comet with a diameter of 2 kilometers traveling at a speed of 50 kilometers per second. Before examining the results of the calculator, I want to provide some perspective about what a 2-kilometer comet looks like. The Chicxulub asteroid that killed the dinosaurs measured 10 kilometers in diameter, which is only 1/10 of the distance from the surface of the Earth to the Kármán line that denotes the end of the atmosphere and the beginning of space. The Younger Dryas comet, with a diameter of 2 kilometers, was just a tiny speck compared to the size of the Earth. If it had hit solid ground, it would have made a smaller crater and its kill radius would have been about 500 kilometers. But by hitting ice, which has 1/3 the density of rock, the icy ejecta went much farther and had a kill radius of about 1,500 kilometers. New Yorkers will understand the size of the comet better by comparing it to Central Park in the center of Manhattan. The comet would cover half of Central Park from West 59th Street to West 85th Street. Those familiar with Washington, D.C. need to compare the comet to the National Mall that stretches from the Lincoln Memorial to the U.S. Capitol. The 2-kilometer comet would just fit between the Lincoln Memorial and the Smithsonian Castle. Californians can compare the comet with the Golden Gate Bridge. The comet would be as wide as the Golden Gate Strait, which is the entrance between the Pacific Ocean and San Francisco Bay. The calculation of the comet impact yields some absolutely astounding numbers. The program did not have an option for specifying an ice target, so I selected loose sand. Sand has a higher density than ice, so the results will underestimate the size of the crater, but they provide an approximation based on the laws of physics and the properties of the materials. The impact would have created a 20-kilometer transient crater that would become a 40-kilometer final crater. The crater formation time would be 31 seconds, and the energy of the impact would be equivalent to 3.75 teratons of TNT, or 3.75 trillion tons of TNT. It is difficult to imagine the magnitude of such an explosion. One of the most powerful explosions in recorded history is the 1883 eruption of the Krakatoa volcano. It propelled ash to a height of 80 kilometers and had energy equivalent to 200 megatons of TNT. Material shot out of the volcano at 2,575 kilometers per hour or 715 meters per second. The explosion of Krakatoa was enormous, but it was 18,000 times smaller than the Younger Dryas comet impact that we calculated. Shuvalov and Dipik developed numerical models of extraterrestrial impacts by projectiles of different sizes. For large impacts, these authors say that in the 1,000-meter scale impact, the mass of ejecta is so large that it moves the atmosphere itself to high altitudes. Thus, the atmosphere cannot decelerate even the fine ejecta, and they consequently expand to the rarefied upper atmosphere. In the upper atmosphere, even fine ejecta move more or less ballistically and therefore may travel to high altitudes. The movement of the atmosphere along with the ice ejecta during the Younger Dryas comet impact means that the ice boulders did not encounter significant aerodynamic resistance during the 30 seconds of the excavation stage, but rather, the ice pieces were carried along with the mass of air being lifted by the explosion caused by the comet impact. We can use ballistic equations to estimate the launch speeds needed for the ice boulders to reach from the Great Lakes to the East Coast and Nebraska. Depending on the launch angles, the speeds are from 3 to 4 kilometers per second. These speeds are 4 to 5 times faster than the material ejected by Krakatoa. At these speeds, the ejected glacier ice boulders would have reached at least 90 kilometers above the surface of the Earth during the 30 seconds of excavation, and the air density is so low at this elevation that it would have negligible drag on the ejected ice. Once above the atmosphere, the projectiles would move unimpeded until they re-entered the atmosphere. The modification stage follows shortly after the excavation flow has opened the transient crater and the ejecta has been launched into ballistic trajectories. Then, a major change takes place in the motion of debris within and beneath the crater. Instead of flowing upward and away from the crater center, the debris comes to a momentary halt and then begins to move downward and back toward the center. This collapse is due to gravity and the elastic rebound of the underlying, compressed layers of the target. Crater modification after an impact on an ice sheet consists of a cavity of incandescent material on the ground surrounded by the fractured remains of the ice sheet. The cavity may not be recognized as a typical crater because the energy of the impact was attenuated by the ice cover. The ice surrounding the cavity will melt and clouds of steam will form as the water flows into the hot cavity. While this is happening at the point of impact, the ejected ice boulders are traveling in suborbital space flights that will re-enter the atmosphere 6 to 9 minutes after the extraterrestrial impact. Glacier ice close to 0 degrees Celsius has a compressive strength of 3 to 15 megapascals. This means that some weak ice boulders could have fragmented at an altitude of 5 kilometers above the surface during re-entry, but at a speed of 3.5 kilometers per second, the pieces would have hit the ground 1.4 seconds after the fragmentation. A strike by a crushed but closely grouped collection of fragments would produce a single crater, although it could have an anomalous morphology. In general, all ice boulders with a compressive strength of 10 or more megapascals would have survived their passage through the atmosphere and would have impacted the ground to create inclined conical cavities that transformed into elliptical basins by the seismic vibrations of the multitude of adjacent impacts. The result of the glacier ice bombardment was a landscape that looked like the surface of the moon, where neither animals nor plants could have survived. This is a LiDAR image of Carolina Bays, 25 kilometers southwest of Fayetteville, North Carolina. A histogram of the bay sizes shows that the most prevalent Carolina Bays have a length of about 250 meters. These bays would have been made by ice projectiles measuring 50 meters in diameter. Assuming that the projectiles that made the Carolina Bays have the same scaling characteristics as the experimental impacts, some of the largest bays measuring over 4 kilometers in length were made by ice boulders as big as 800 meters in diameter. The Carolina Bays and the Nebraska rainwater basins are oriented toward the Great Lakes. Their convergence point provides a clue about the location of an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet that launched pieces of glacier ice in ballistic trajectories. There are multiple convergence points, so it is possible that multiple fragments of a disintegrating comet impacted the Laurentide ice sheet. A paper by Ledet et al. Tells us that Lake Agassiz started draining eastward toward the North Atlantic between 13,000 to 12,700 years ago. This channel opening was concurrent with decreased runoff to the Gulf of Mexico and increased runoff through the lower Great Lakes to the Gulf of St. Lawrence and North Atlantic. An extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet at the onset of the Younger Dryas could have fragmented the ice by the Great Lakes and opened up the eastern outlet for the drainage of Lake Agassiz. The impact could also have triggered the megafaunal extinction and dispersed platinum-rich material that created a sedimentary layer with a high level of platinum. There is still much to be learned. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas cataclysm. The Carolina Bays should not be neglected. Ask your geology professors to discuss the Carolina Bays because they are the most prevalent geological structures in the Atlantic coastal plain. There is a link to the LiDAR visualization tool in the description of the video. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.